I think of my family, and I know what would happen to my family if I were raped, or if my daughters were raped. I imagine all of you in this room, everybody sitting here, can think just for a moment of their daughters, their sons, their wives, husbands. If they were raped, what would that do to your family structure? What would that do to their lives, to your family structure? And what would you would want support, you would want, but you would want to know that it was wrong and that the world thought it was wrong and that the person that did this to you doesn't just walk free and get away with it. So in whatever way that needs to be done, that's what you need. That's part of your healing, so you can move forward in your life. It's what they deserve, because we know that this terrorist group that we are dealing with in Syria and Iraq is absolutely using rape they are dictating it as policy. This is what is beyond something we've seen before. Yes, it's organized, but it is actually put into their policy. They are saying this is that you should do this. This is the right way to build a society. We are going to do this and cleanse this and use this, and so we ask you to rape. So yes, I think we really have to have a very, very, very strong response at this time to this particular group on this issue.
Thank you, Lord Chairman. Lords and ladies, I'm very grateful to be here today and to have the opportunity to speak with you and to express my gratitude for the United Kingdom for their leadership on this issue. For over 10 years, I had been visiting the field and meeting with families and survivors of sexual violence who felt for so long that their voices simply didn't matter. They weren't heard, and they carried a great shame. I remember distinctly meeting this little girl who was very young, probably about 7 or 8, and she was rocking backwards and forwards and staring at the wall and tears streaming down her face because she had been brutally raped multiple times. You couldn't talk to her, you couldn't touch her. I felt absolutely helpless and didn't know what to do for her. More recently, I met a 13-year-old girl in Iraq who had been kept in a room with many other girls, and they were taken out in twos, brought to this very dirty room with this dirty couch and raped repeatedly. But they told me that what was even worse than the physical violence was that they then had to stand in rooms and watch their friends be sold, and to hear men arguing about what they were worth. Were they worth $40, $50? What was the price of them? What was their value? And how humiliating that was and demoralizing. And it made her question what she was worth. And knowing that, and knowing that people around the world know of her situation, wondering why there wasn't enough being done to stop it. So knowing them, it did mean a great deal to me to be with the Foreign Secretary of the United Kingdom in the Congo and hear him speak to girls and express his opinion that they should have no shame, that it is not their fault, that the shame should be on the perpetrators, and that he would do what he could. I saw what that meant, and I had the privilege then of being at the G8 to witness the foreign ministers, powerful countries around the world, speaking about these issues and trying to figure out what best needs to be done. Then at the summit, with civil society, NGOs, and governments coming together to talk about what could be done. And now today, what it means to be here with you and this committee and your parliament, knowing that you are studying the best ways to help these women. And so I think that speaks to these young girls about their value. That's the answer. We do value them. We're going to work together. And I'm very happy to be here, to be a part of this with you today. So I thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions.